welcome everybody. It's really good to be back. That piece was called Breathe. And I think we should all take a moment here and breathe. We'd like to start our service today, May 23rd, with "We are one in the Spirit." It's a wonderful thing to remember. Always, we are always one in the Spirit, no matter where we are in the world. And I'm certainly glad, though, to be back here with you this morning, and Margie. Here we go.
Thank you, Janice, and thank you, Margie. And Janice, we are so blessed to have you back with us safe and sound. Thank you. And we also want to thank Faye Cooley, who was incredible stepping up to the plate and playing wonderful music with Margie while Janice was away. Well, good morning, Unity of Roanoke Valley. Happy Pentecost. Today is Pentecost, and we are going to be celebrating and talking about Pentecost then and Pentecost now. But let's start out by blessing the Christ candle. And let's say that great, wonderful unity affirmation. There is only one presence and one power in our lives and in the universe, God, the good, omnipotent. David Wilkerson, Reverend David Wilkerson, who's had a powerful ministry with gangs, street gangs in New York City and Brooklyn and other areas. David Wilkerson says, when you strip it of everything else, Pentecost stands for power and life, stands for power and life. And also stands for this stuff, it starts really being heart knowledge and stops being just head knowledge, where we can really take, when we're facing a difficult situation, in the middle of the crisis, we can really start to take in that one presence and one power and really start to feel that maybe even this challenge can be an opportunity which can lead us into new areas of spiritual growth. And it really gives us, as David Wilkerson said, power, life, and it also gives us a really robust faith. And today's daily word happens to be faith, and the affirmation is, my faith keeps me focused on God. I may not be able to control what happens around me, but I am always free to choose what happens within me. My perception determines my experience. I begin with faith. I choose to see the vibrant wholeness that is present, even during illness. I open my heart and mind to the harmony that I know possible, even in the midst of apparent discord. When my needs appear greater than my resources, I remind myself all supply springs forth from that inexhaustible well of divine substance. I am reassured by remembering all situations are temporary and God is greater than every circumstance, every circumstance. Through my faith, I align my thoughts with the divine and believe in this truth that sets me free. And from the Gospel of Luke, we read, if you have faith the size of a mustard seed, you could say to this mulberry tree, be uprooted and planted in the sea, and it would obey you. Today's daily word is faith. And, you know, the reality is that there may be some times where our faith is really super strong, other times where it may not be. But one of the ways then to get us back into that faith and what was really going on in that upper room during Pentecost was prayer. Prayer has been at the center and heart of the unity movement from the get-go, and it certainly is here. Call your prayer requests into us at 540-562-2200, 540-562-2200. And here to lead us in prayer, we are really so blessed to have such an incredible spiritual care team here at Unity of Roanoke Valley. We have wonderful prayer chaplains here to receive your prayers, to pray with you, to phone call you, to do all that. And leading us in prayer now is Chris Cameron from the prayer team. Thank you, Chris, for being here, and thank you for leading us in prayer.
Thank you, Reverend Rick. Faith. Faith is indeed what we draw on each time that we pray. So let's take a moment. Close your eyes. Take in a deep breath. And feel that presence within. That presence of spirit, of infinite presence. And in this space of healing light, love, and peace, we hold each of those whose names may appear in this prayer box, on our prayer lists, those we hold in our hearts and our minds. And we are so grateful that we know that all is indeed working toward the highest and best for each one. And we hold in that space of infinite possibility with strong faith that all is indeed well, all is working in divine order, and we are so grateful, and so we allow it to be. Amen.
Amen. And now we'll be led into a time of prayer and meditation by Janice and Margie with their wonderful music.
Power and His grace. hush around us. I see glory on each face. Surely the presence of the Lord is in this place.
Surely the presence of the Lord is in this place. Let's take a little trip of the mind's eye and in our time machines. Let's go back even before that first Pentecost. Let's go back to that upper room in Jerusalem, and Skip is putting up one picture of what it might have been like. In that upper room, here we are at the Last Supper, the Last Seder. Then came crucifixion. Then the disciples, according to Scripture, meeting the resurrected Christ. And I don't care whether you take this literally, metaphysically, or some combination of the two, it is an incredibly powerful story for this modern era. They met that divine presence who said, wait in Jerusalem. And so they went back into that upper room. And then one Sunday, 50 days after Easter, according to legend, they truly felt that bright wind of the Spirit. They felt that power. There may be times in our lives where that connection with the divine can get musty and dusty. But when we can come into our own prayer closet, our own upper room, and feel that connection, that we are truly one with the One, then there is a new bounce in our stride. There is faith. There is the feeling, as Paul told the Philippians, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. And we get the power to face our demons and to overcome them. That was the power that the disciples felt on that first Pentecost. And we feel so blessed knowing that the age of miracles is not past. Maybe it won't be tongues of fire over our head or something like that. It could be softer and gentler, subtler. But it is a knowing. We know that we know that we know. And life takes on a new meaning and positive purpose. And with this feeling, truly feeling of unity and knowing of unity, we gladly go into the silence. Thank you, dear Spirit. Thank you for these Pentecostal experiences which are still open to us in the 21st century. This isn't just something that happened way back when, but it's something which we can have in our lives now. And for this and so much more, we say thank you and amen and amen. Thank you, Janice, and thank you, Margie. Thank you, Chris, and thank you to our AV wizards. Thank you, Skip, and thank you, Cody. This week, I mean, and it's not unusual, I get comments about what they're putting on at the end of the service, but this week in particular, a person came up to me and said, you know, I saw last week's service. It was pretty good, but I got to tell you, what Skip and Cody put on at the end, that was great. That was great. Don't turn off your machines at the end because they're putting stuff up which are, the stuff is funny. I mean, first off, it's funny, but, you know, it's spiritually spot on. So don't turn off your machines at the end of the service. Well, in many religions, this is not an unusual practice in many different faiths, but it's interesting over time to see various holidays often rise and fall in terms of importance. If I could put my Jewish roots on, or go into my Jewish roots for a minute, in Judaism, Hanukkah was essentially, you know, for years, for decades, for centuries, a minor Jewish festival. Recently in North America, Hanukkah has really shot up in importance, and I think I could tell a story as to one of the reasons why. I was very good friends with Rabbi Eugene Lippman. Gene was president of the Reform Jewish Movement, the liberal branch of Judaism, for a good number of years. And Gene told me, Rabbi Lippman told me the story. One day, his little son was really angry. And so he went to his little son, he said, what's the matter? And the son wouldn't say anything. And so Gene said, well, can you draw me a picture? So the kid went down and drew a picture, and the picture was of a Christmas tree, and it was easy to see that he was also drawing Santa Claus. He was angry, you know, a lot of his friends were getting Christmas trees and Santa Claus and all this. Gene saw the picture. You didn't need a long rabbinical exegesis on the picture. Hanukkah, the importance of Hanukkah really shot up in the Lippman family. And that happened in many, many Jewish households. And the importance now of Hanukkah is much higher than it was even, I remember, as a kid. The same thing has happened in Christianity, too. Holidays as terms of importance have risen and fallen. For example, Christmas. Christmas was always an important holiday in Christendom, but it wasn't always numero uno. I mean, there were many centuries or whatever where Easter was more important, quite frankly, than Easter was more important than Christmas. For example, and I'm Skip is now putting up a picture. This is a picture of Mount Vernon, actually a dining room in Mount Vernon, George Washington's home. And many winters, they will decorate it to look like what Mount Vernon in Christmas time would have looked like in George Washington's day. And it is fascinating to see people traipse through Mount Vernon, look around, where's the Christmas tree? No Christmas tree. I mean, look at this picture that Skip has put up of the dining room. I mean, it looks very nice, but it does not look like, you know, it doesn't look like, you know, Christmas is the numero uno holiday. It looks like a very nice table for a typical Sunday meal or whatever. But Christmas recently, or, you know, say recently, think of 100 years, 100 or 200 years, has really, really, really shot up in importance. Meanwhile, the holiday of Pentecost, which we are celebrating today, has taken, you know, as almost in many circles, has taken a nosedive, as it were, downwards. But if I were king of the forest, remember the Wizard of Oz and the Cowardly Lion and Bert Lahr singing, if I were king of the forest? Well, if I were king of the forest, Pentecost would be right up there with Christmas in terms of importance and in terms of how we would be celebrating it. So today, I would like to convince you of several things. First, I'd like to convince you about the real importance of Pentecost. And second, if you've not had a Pentecostal experience, and I'll try to also convince you, Pentecostal experience, you don't have to be a holy roller and roll around on the floor speaking in tongues. In Unity, the pioneers in Unity had Pentecostal experiences, which were very different from, you know, speaking in tongues and rolling around on the floor. But if you've not had a Pentecostal experience, I'd like to convince you of the importance of having this in your life. And if you've not had one in a long while, I'd like to convince you that it might be something which you would strive and really, really honestly, truly want. The reason is because these Pentecostal experiences, I believe, really make all the difference in the world in terms of our spiritual walk. They really make all the difference in the world. A little historical background. And first, I hope you don't mind again if I step into my Jewish roots. Jesus, the movement that went around Jesus was not unusual in Palestine, in the Holy Land during the first century under the Romans. There were many, many Jewish messiahs. It was almost during the first century. It was almost like the Messiah of the Month Club. I'm being a little facetious, but not all that much. There were many. There were many, many Jewish messianic movements. None of them, except the one around Jesus, lasted. None of them. Some of them, when they started showing the boards and nails, the leader of the movement would say, wait a minute, something must have got lost in translation. I never claimed that. I never claimed, and you know, back down or whatever. But of those who did not and went through crucifixion, their movements might have lasted for 2 months. Some even lasted 2 or 3 years. But not one of them, outside of the movement around Jesus, lasted, stuck, took on. Now, there may be many reasons why that's the case, but I believe that one of the key reasons had to do with that Pentecostal experience, with that Pentecost experience. When, after the crucifixion, and again, I don't care whether you take these stories literally, metaphysically, or some combination of the two. I say to my traditional, you know, Christian friends, some of them who are fundamentalists, I say to them, even if you literally believe that this happened 2,000 years ago, you still, in 2021, have to say to yourself, metaphysically, what does this mean to me now? Is it just something that happened in the past and that's it? Or what does it mean? What does it mean to me actually now? But anyway, after the crucifixion, resurrection, the disciples went up to Galilee where Jesus said he would meet with them. And Jesus said to them, wait in Jerusalem. Wait in Jerusalem where you will be filled with spirit and you will be filled with power. So they went back down to Jerusalem. They went back to that upper room. And quite frankly, they were scared in their boots. They were quaking in their boots or quaking in their sandals. And I'm not trying to put them down at all. I think, you know, quite frankly, if I were there, I probably would have gone very low profile. I don't know if I would have had the courage to have gone into the upper room after what happened. I mean, let's face it. The Roman authorities were not their friends. The Jewish temple authorities certainly were not their friends. It was a very, very scary time period. And they were really hunker in the bunker as it were. But then, 50 days after Easter, on that Sunday of Pentecost, something happened. And the interesting thing is, if you go back and look at the Gospels, you look at the Koine Greek, you look at the original Greek, it doesn't say tongues of fire. It doesn't say, you know, there was actually like a big fan going through, blowing wind or whatever. It says it like a metaphor, like a metaphysical metaphor. The Greek actually does say, like tongues of fire, like a bright wind. So it's, you know, we're dealing with beautiful poetic images. But something happened. Something happened that truly changed the disciples on Pentecost. And they no longer were just hunkering in the bunker. They unbolted the doors. They went out and they started getting super bold. Super bold. Something happened. And I believe what happened was, and again, you know, what you a lot of times read in the Gospels, again, it's poetic images. But something happened that got them to be bold. And I believe that that something happened was that they had that direct experience with divine mind. They had that direct experience. It was no longer secondhand religion or secondhand spirituality. It was a direct experience. It was a direct experience. Let me make an analogy. I remember a number of years ago, was very interested in French cuisine, French cooking. And, you know, people in the know said to me, you know, Rick, even if you go to a great French restaurant in the United States, it is nothing compared to the wonders of a 4 or 5 star French restaurant actually in La Belle France. And so I would be there and I was reading Julia Child cookbooks, and I remember there was Gourmet magazine, and every time Gourmet magazine had something about French cooking, I would read it. Or my God, if they had an article about going to a restaurant in Paris or going to an auberge, an inn in the countryside, I would read those Gourmet magazine. But, you know, it was really secondhand. Then I made my first trip ever to France. And a good friend who was very well connected with French society, French culture, he said, here, go to this restaurant. It's a 4-star restaurant. This is an up-and-coming chef. And it's not in the greatest sense place of Paris, but it is a restaurant that really is, you know, on the up-and-up. So we got in the taxi, and the taxi is winding away, and I thought, oh my God, you know, what district is this? Or, you know, it looked like it wasn't going to be the right place. And we got in the taxi driver, you know, voila. And so we get out, and, you know, we walk in, and inside it turns out to be this incredibly beautiful restaurant. I had given the name to the maitre d'. The chef even came out and, you know, and said, oh, you're friends of the, you know, and oh my God, did send him my best. And I've done something very special for you folks. And he out came, oh my God, the difference from actually being in a 4-star restaurant compared to reading about it in Gourmet magazine. I can't tell you all the difference in the world. And then around a week later, we were out in Versailles in the countryside, and we sort of stumbled. We stumbled on a 5-star French country inn and had a meal there. It was, oh my God, it was incredible. That's the difference between sort of a secondhand experience and directly experiencing it. It's the difference between reading about a love affair and actually being in a love affair. That's what Pentecost is all about. You know, and I love some other stories in the Bible which I think also tie on this, the story of Job. At the end of the book of Job, Job says, I don't understand why all this stuff happened to me. I still don't understand it. But before this stuff happened to me, I had only heard about God. But now, after going through this experience, I have experienced God. I have experienced God. Or even doubting Thomas. I mean, and I'd like to give you another take on Thomas. I mean, because I think Thomas gets so knocked. I mean, the gospel according to Thomas is as early as any of the four gospels, which are, you know, the canonical official gospels. But for he must have had his enemies or whatever. It was, you know, it was not sanctioned by the early church, although the Gospel of Thomas is such a wonderful, wonderful document. But anyway, think of it this way. Jesus appeared in the upper room to all the other apostles, except to Thomas. Thomas comes in, they tell him, you know, what happened. He said, you know, until I can touch until I put my hand in the wounds and all that, like the monkeys. I'm not going to be like the monkeys. I'm not a believer, as it were. And the next week, doubting Thomas comes in, and there is the resurrected Jesus. And again, I don't care whether you take the story literally, metaphysically, or some combination of the two, but Jesus then says, put your hands in my, you know, the wounds on him. Thomas says, you know, falls to his knees, my God, you know, and all that. Let me give another take on that. What Thomas, you know, might have been saying is, I don't want a secondhand experience of the divine. I want a direct experience. I want a direct experience. And I think that is what Pentecost, Job, doubting Thomas, and there are so many modern examples of this. What they are all about are people who, in essence, had secondhand spirituality. They had gourmet magazine spirituality, secondhand religion. They were reading about love affairs instead of being in a love affair. And something happened that moved them, that kickstarted them into a firsthand direct spiritual experience. And having this firsthand experience, this Pentecostal experience, makes all the difference in the world. Look, I wish I could tell you if you followed all the Unity 5 principles, you know, nothing bad is ever going to happen to you in all this, but I think the reality is this. We are all going to experience at some time a metaphysical falling of the ashpan. We are all going to wake up some morning, maybe it's not us, maybe it's some other family member or dear friend, and there is going to be a serious hitch in our giddy app. A serious hitch in our giddy app. We are all going to face situations where we think, boy, this situation is a slam dunk. And instead, what happens? We get slam dunk. Oh my God, we get slam dunk. There's also going to be times where we think, at long last, finally, I have a bottle of high papalorum. I have a bottle of high papalorum. And it turns out to be nothing more than a bottle of low papa hiram. At those points, if all we have are gourmet magazine articles, talks of, you know, about, you know, stories about a love affair instead of being in a love affair, if we do not have those intimate, direct, if it just remains head knowledge and is not heart knowledge, then when we take these knocks in life, many of us will be down for the count. Many of us will become professional victims. We'll look at things like unity and think, oh my God, that's just a bunch of happy babble. That's just a bunch of happy babble. But when we have our Pentecostal experience, then we can face calamity with serenity. We can face calamity with serenity. People, you know, people will be looking at us and saying, my God, If that happened to you 10 years ago, you would have been a fruitcake. You would have been a basket case. But now look at how you're here. What do you have? How did you do it? My God, I want what you have. And in unity, that was the case. I mean, for Myrtle Fillmore to, you know, it wasn't a case of after she went through that healing process in the 1880s. It wasn't that, you know, she had to put on a suit and tie and get on a bicycle and start converting the world. People came to her. How did you do that? Another example of the difference when you have that Pentecostal, that direct experience, it was the Great Depression. And I love this story. It was the Great Depression. And remember, we've gone through some financial knocks through COVID and all that. But what we've gone through compared to the Great Depression, what we've gone through compared to what people went through in the Great Depression looks like a Sunday school picnic in comparison. It was the Great Depression. And Unity Village, they had acquired the land, all those acres of land, and they had dreams of what they were going to build. And they started with that wonderful tower, that wonderful clock tower. It looks like something out of either out of Venice or out of Florence from the Italian Renaissance. And they just dedicated it. They just dedicated the building of that tower. And one of Unity's key backers in the Great Depression came up to Myrtle Fillmore and said to Myrtle, "Oh my God, I just hope we don't run out of money." Myrtle turned to the guy and said, "Oh, I'm not concerned that we run out of money. I'm just concerned that we not run out of faith, that we not run out of faith." When you have that experience, then you can face even the Great Depression and you're not worried about running out of money. You're thinking more in terms of faith. You think more in terms of faith. I could see people coming up to us and saying, "You know, I went to that Unity service and at the end you sing that peace song. And then you say that prayer for protection. And at the end of it, you say, and all of that prayer for protection, you say, and all is well." I mean, have you looked at the world lately? Have you looked at the world lately? All is well? Come on. And then we can turn to that person and say, "You've left something important. You've left something out that's really important." What we say, "And because God is. And because God is, all is well." It is because of that direct connection that we can say at a very profound and deep level, all is well, despite appearances. No wonder Jesus said to the apostles, "Go back to Jerusalem, go back to the upper room, and wait until you are filled with this type of Pentecostal experience." Because without it, I believe that the Jesus movement would have been just another flash in the pan, another Jewish Messiah movement, which would maybe last for, you know, maybe a year or two, and that's it. But that was not what happened. And the neat thing is that these Pentecostal experiences, and again, doesn't have to be holy roller, on the floor and all that. These experiences that when it stops being head knowledge, starts being heart knowledge. When it stops being reading about a love affair and it really becomes a love affair. The age of miracles is not dead. It happens now. And let me tell you just one story, a very modern story of this type of Pentecostal experience. And Skip is putting a picture of the person I want to talk about. Her name is Jocelyn Edmonds. There she is. And she's right next to her, you know, with their hands around each other. That's not her grandfather. That's the police officer who arrested her at the time when she was sent up the river. And they are quite good friends now. Anyway, Jocelyn was she lives in Phil Campbell, Alabama. Phil Campbell is south of Huntsville, but it's north of Birmingham. So it's between Huntsville and Birmingham. Anyway, Jocelyn, she was in not such great marriage, but it was a marriage, and she had two kids. And she was an electrical worker at a mobile home factory, so she's making fairly good money for that neck of the woods. And she goes through a divorce. She's a single mother now, trying to raise two kids, and she develops cancer, a very painful form of cancer. And the doctors start giving her opioids. And so she is on opioids. The cancer looks like it's gone, but she still wants opioids. The doctors won't give her opioids. She is going to the plant trying to bum drugs off of people that she's working with. It doesn't stand her too well with her employer. Eventually, she is fired. She then has to deal with drug dealers to get the stuff. It eventually reaches the point, I didn't know this. I didn't know you could actually literally shoot OxyContins, but she was shooting OxyContins. And it was expensive. To feed her habit, she has to go into stealing. And she is arrested, taken down, first time given, put into rehab. And the second time when she is arrested, because she continues in this loop, the officer that arrested her was Officer Terrell Potter. And the irony of this, again, small town, Officer Terrell Potter was the father of her high school her girlfriend in high school. Oh my God, being arrested by the father of what was your girlfriend and all that. This time she gets jail. She gets jail time. And serious jail time. She's eventually out in rehab because she really went to 12-step fellowship. She went all over the place to try to kick this habit. So she has a meeting. She's out of jail now. She's in rehab, and she's meeting with her caseworker and her probation officer. And she says to them, I shouldn't be saying this to my probation officer and my caseworker, but the honest truth is I feel I'm just a crime machine waiting to happen. I can't kick this habit. I've tried. I just can't kick it. I will do whatever God says. And the caseworker looked at her and said, well, what do you think God would want? And Jocelyn said, I think God would want me to be clean. I want me to be clean, but I can't do it. It was at that moment that Jocelyn had her Pentecostal experience, and she remembered reading in one of the 12-step literatures that God could, that it was literally, it said that God could and would if he were sought. God could and would if he were sought. And that line came alive for her. That line came alive for her. It wasn't easy, but she then felt that direct connection, that Pentecostal experience. And since then has been able to kick drugs. And she's actually founded a place called the Place of Grace Center, the Place of Grace Center, which actually helps women who are going through difficult, violence in homes, going through drug addictions. She has been an incredible, powerful force. So I could hear some of you saying, I would love to have this, Pentecostal experience, Rick. How do you get it? And the truth be known, I don't know. I don't know. Because I think, quite frankly, we don't serve a one-size-fits-all time of God. I believe the divine power that we are connected with is more like hold the pickles, hold the lettuce, special orders, don't upset us. There is no simple, way or procedure of doing this. But I do believe several things. One, I think we should really take Jesus' words seriously. Jesus said, seek and you will find. Knock and the door will open. Take that as a personal promise to you that if you truly seek this, you will get it. If you truly knock, you will find. It reminds me it's a story about a Zen master. Now, some of these stories about Zen masters can be really pretty violent. They're kicking and hitting and all. Don't do this at home, boys and girls. But anyway, The story about a Zen master, he has a student, and the student says, I can't get a direct relationship with the divine. I don't feel the divine. I don't have this relationship. He didn't use the word Pentecost, obviously, but I don't feel this direct connection. It's head knowledge, not heart knowledge. And the Zen master says to the student, says, come here, I'll help you get this experience. They go down to the stream. The Zen master says, stick your head under the water. And so the student sticks his head under the water. Then the Zen master clamps under his arms, clamps and gives him a headlock, holding his head under the water. The student is feeling, oh my God, what's going, has the Zen master gone crazy? And he's pushing to try to get up and get some oxygen, and he can't, and he's, my God, the Zen master is trying to drown me. What's going on? Finally, he pushes his head up above the water. He starts breathing. The Zen master looks at the student and says, the moment you want a direct relationship with the divine, half as much as you wanted that oxygen, you'll have a direct experience with the divine. Again, boys and girls, don't do this at home. I'm glad in unity we tend to use kinder and softer language than that. But I think there's a grain of truth to that. There's a grain of truth to that Zen story. That when we knock and truly knock, it will happen. If this is something we truly feel is important in our lives, it will happen. Let's go into prayer a moment. Dear Spirit, thank you that the age of miracles is not past. Thank you that it is possible to have Pentecostal experiences in our own day, that direct knowledge. That we too, instead of reading Gourmet magazine, can actually go to the inn. Can actually go to the inn. Jesus said, it is the Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. And part of that kingdom is that feast, that direct experience, that power to help us do what we cannot do alone. And so on this Pentecost, we say thank you for all of this. And amen, and amen. Thank you, and God bless. Thank you, Janice. And now we come to the time of tithes, gifts, love offerings, and we are so blessed to have so many people who have supported us over the pandemic. As Jim Rosemurgy, that great Unity minister and teacher, he wrote a book by this title, Even Mystics Have to Pay Bills, and it's your support that has kept us going, and we face so many wonderful, positive opportunities now through YouTube services, online classes, and now opening up with the 11 o'clock live Sunday service here in the sanctuary to really spread the Unity message. And I know that a lot of folks have liked to come up and get affirmations. We will be going back to that very soon, but let me pick one affirmation which can stand for all of us. I focus on the good, bringing out the best in every situation. I focus on the good, bringing out the best in every situation. You can go online to make donations at our website, unityofroanokevalley.org. That's all one word. unityofroanokevalley.org. You can give online or through snail mail. Our address is Unity of Roanoke Valley, 3300 Green Ridge Road, Roanoke, Virginia, 24019. That is Unity of Roanoke Valley, 3300 Green Ridge Road, Roanoke, Virginia, 24019. And let's say that great blessing. Divine love flowing through me blesses and multiplies all that I have, all that I give, and all that I am open to receive, and I am grateful. A few quick announcements. We've started a new class on Emmett Fox's wonderful book, The Sermon on the Mount. It meets on Wednesdays online at 7 p.m. If you wish to join us, give a call to the office at 540-562-2200, 540-562-2200. Give us your name, give us your email address, and we will make sure that the Zoom invite goes out to you. Also, we are doing a live 11 o'clock Sunday service in the sanctuary, socially distanced, masked, and all that. Call us or give us a reservation. You can make a reservation at URV Seats. URV Seats at yahoo.com. Come on down. We're also doing fellowship in both the Fellowship Hall and the Rose Garden, open doors, and it's really wonderful. And lastly, I would strongly suggest, you know, come down to the wonderful 26 acres. This really is a sacred oasis at Unity of Roanoke Valley. Come on down. The roses are in bloom. The new fountain is there. Go to the labyrinth, walk the labyrinth, walk the nature trails. It is just a beautiful place to sit and meditate and really feel that divine connection. And with that, we have such a wonderful way of closing.
Let there be peace on earth, and let it begin with me. God's children all are we. Yes, we walk with each other in perfect harmony. Yes, peace begins with me. Yes, this is the moment now. With every breath I take, yes, this is my joyous vow. To take each moment and live each moment in peace eternal.
The light of God surrounds us, the love of God enfolds us, the power of God protects us, and the presence of God watches over us. Wherever we are, God is. Important line. And because God is, all is well. And Spirit says, knock and the door will be opened, seek and you will find. And all the people said, amen.
Something.